Welcome to Good Friday service. The service is a continuation from last night, Maundy Thursday's service. You will remain seated for the entire service this night. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who journeyed with us for these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen.
Holy, holy, holy.
You have made us with your own hands, O God. We are content in your loving hands, O Lord. Your hands were the skilled hands of a carpenter. By your labor, you have dignified the work of our own hands.
We are blessed in your loving hands, O Lord.
But our hands have often been at work doing evil. Sometimes our hands are caught in the very act of sin. Sometimes they take up stones to destroy others trapped in their own web of sin. It is in your hand that we find mercy. We find comfort in your loving hands, O Lord. It was your sinless hands that were spread wide in blessing and nailed high on a cross to cancel the debt of our sinful deeds.
We find forgiveness in your loving hands, O Lord.
The salvation you have given to us has made us unafraid of death. For when we shed these earthly tents, you will give us a permanent dwelling in your eternal kingdom.
Your hands provide all that we need in life and in death, O Lord.
Luke tells of Christ's crucifixion. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail. And you, when once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. And he said to him, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, the cock will not crow this day until you have denied three times. And he said to them, when I send you out without a purse, a bag, or sandal, do you lack anything? And they said, no, not a thing. And he said to them, but now, the one who has a purse must take it, and likewise a bag. And the one who has no sword may sell this cloak and buy one. For I tell you, this scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was counted among the lawless. And indeed, what is written about me is being fulfilled, Jesus says. And they said, Lord, look, here are two swords. And Jesus replied, it is enough.
Thank you.
And Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When Jesus reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." And when he withdrew from them, about a stone's throw away, he knelt down and he prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove the cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to Jesus and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. When Jesus got up from the prayer, he came to the disciples and he found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to the disciples, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray, so that you may not come into this time of trial." While Jesus was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading the crowd. As Judas approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?" When those were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike him with a sword?" Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched the soldier's ear and he healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priest, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who would come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay a hand on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness."
Thank you.
Then they seized Jesus and they led him away, bringing him to the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter said among them, and a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at Peter, and he said, this man also was with him. But Peter denied it, saying, woman, I do not know him. A little later, someone else, on seeing Peter, said, you also are one of them. Peter said for a second time, man, I am not. Then about an hour later, still another keeping insistent, surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean. But Peter said for the third time, man, I do not know what you are talking about. And at that moment, while Peter was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the cock crows today, you will deny knowing me three times. And Peter left and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, prophesy, who is it that struck you? They kept heaping many other insults at Jesus. And when day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought Jesus to their council. They said, if you are the Messiah, tell us. And Jesus The beaten one replied, "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." All of them asked him, "Are you then the Son of God?" Jesus said to them, "You say that I am." And they said, "What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips." Then the assembly rose as a body, and they brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse Jesus, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Then Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." And the crowd was insistent, and they said, "He stirs up people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where they began, even in this place." But when Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean, and we learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction. Pilate sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been waiting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. Herod questioned Jesus at length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing Jesus. Even Herod with his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then they put on an elegant robe on him, and they sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other, because they had been enemies. Pilate then called together to the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and he said to them, "You brought me this man as one who has perverted the people. And here I am, examined him under your presence, and have found nothing that this man is guilty of. He is not guilty of any of your charges against him. And neither has Herod, for he sent Jesus back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate.
In the shadow.
Then they all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us!" This was a man who had been put in prison for insurrection that had taken place in the city for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And a third time, Pilate says to the crowd, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man that they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over to them as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on Simon and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and he said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren and the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when the wood is dry?" Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with Jesus. When they came to the place that's called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And the crowd cast lots to divide Jesus's clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he's the Messiah, the Son of God, that chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." And there was an inscription over him that said, "King of the Jews." Sometimes we get so wrapped up in how many mistakes they made way back then, as if we are so detached from that event. I mean, after all, it was some 2,000 years ago, right? That happened way back then, and they did that to Jesus. Last night, we understood that Jesus said to us, "Love one another as I have loved you." Jesus wasn't just talking about the people who were 2,000 years ago. He's talking to me and you today. That we are to love one another as he loves us. And if he's talking to us, then now, for us to love one another, we can't distance ourselves from being the ones who put the nails in his hands. We, not even born, our children's grandchildren's of grandchildren's of grandchildren's of grandchildren's are not even born yet when the crucifixion of Jesus happened. Yet Jesus did it for them, and he has done it for every generation forward. and he will for every generation until he comes again. We were there. Humanity was there. So many times we get in arguments with people and we want to know if it's black and if it's white. And by God, there's no gray area. Amen? We want to know that it's black and it's white. I can tell you tonight that Jesus died for you and there is no gray area. He died especially for you. Sadly, we were there, humanity was there yelling, crucifying, crucifying. We were there too, watching this. As humans, we are there watching this. This baby that came to us in a manger is now going to hang on a cross and die for us. For us. Scripture doesn't say who drove the nails in Jesus' hand. We learn tonight Simon of Cyrene is the one who carries the cross. I tell you that it is us. It is those who Jesus wanted that relationship with so bad. It is us who drove those nails. It is us who Jesus said last night, love one another as I have loved you. And tonight, from that same chalice that we drank last night, I'm going to invite you to come forward and get a nail. Because just as we come and we are fed and we are filled with Jesus' love last night, the world gets turned upside down today when Jesus gets beaten to death and hung on a cross, a place in the edge of town where you don't have to be right there to see it because it's so high on this mountain that the silhouette alone of you seeing three crosses up there is what happens. You know, they didn't crucify him in a basement somewhere where nobody would see him. They put him on a mountain on the edge of a hill so everybody can see him. I think it was their way of mocking him. Because above his head, they put this sign, King of the Jews. So I invite you to come forward from this very chalice that we drank from last night to come up and receive a nail and hold on to that nail until we go outside to the cross. So come. Susan. So it's not just black and white. It's red, too. Jesus gave himself for you. He was willing to give it all up so that we can be made right with Christ, that we can be made right with God. Jesus is willing not to just go 99% in, but he's willing to go the whole way. Even if he's wrongly accused, he's still willing to go. That's a depth of love that Jesus talks to us about. Love one another as I have loved you. Love one another 100%. Not 99.5, but love one another 100%. Love one another as he loves us. Amen. One of the criminals who was hanging there kept deriding Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked that one, and he said, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man, he has done nothing wrong." And the criminal said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
When you come into your kingdom,
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. While the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, then Jesus, crying in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, the centurion praised God and he said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breast. And all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, they stood at a distance, watching these things.